Yash, and welcome to the Science Chat Show. I hope you're doing good. Let's directly start with breaking the ice and make you friends with our audience. So tell us about yourself, your childhood, your family, your educational background, and anything else that you feel will help our audience connect with you.
Hello, Nojo. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm fine, and I hope you're also doing well. Well, first of all, my hello to your viewers. My name is Arshdeep Singh, and I am currently pursuing PhD at the Center for Sustainable Technologies in the Division of Mechanical Sciences at the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Yeah, well, I was born in September 92 in a small city called Kotkapura in Punjab. I've just put a small map of Punjab, so you can see the exact location of Kotkapura, Punjab. So I've also given a small photograph, which I clicked, I think at 5:30 in the morning. So I was born in a very simple but educated family. Both of my parents were working in the Department of Education, Government of Punjab. My father was a lecturer in political science, and he got retired as a principal in May of 2017. And my mother was teaching English at that point of time, and she is also retired in April of 2020. So I had really great childhood. Actually, my father was also born and brought up in the same city. And my father's extended family is also living here. So I have many cousins, and I had a really great time. So here I just put a one picture where we were celebrating Holi. This picture is from the year 2000.
So I think that's your dad, your mom, and the guy in the green shirt is you. And then that's your younger sister.
Yeah.
That's a nice family picture.
Then coming to my schooling, I spent like 12 years in the same school. I studied at Ashoka Model Senior Secondary School in the city itself, and I was there from my first standard till senior secondary. And during my school time, we used to take part in different plays and dance. I was also a member of the Candlelight House, which used to organize different kind of events. Debates and cultural competitions are one of them. And I have shown two pictures here. The first picture on the left hand side is from a play where I was playing a role of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. The second picture was from a dance form where I was representing Kashmir. So I completed my schooling in 2010, and after my schooling I started with my bachelor's in mechanical engineering. So I went to Gyani Jaiswal College of Engineering and Technology in Bathinda. It was also called Government Engineering College Bathinda. And it is one of the oldest engineering colleges in Punjab. It was established in the year 1987. And I think I spent my four wonderful years there. And we had a wonderful time. I have just shown two pictures here, although I have many. So the picture at the left hand side is from the department fest. So we organized this fest, and we were the organizing team. So it was altogether a different experience. The second picture is from our trip to Goa. So we all mechanical engineering guys went for a trip. So this is one of the pictures from that trip. I would like to share one memory here. So when I was going to the college, so after my senior secondary, I was little homesick. So I don't want to live a hostel life. I was little reluctant to it. But my father really insisted upon me that no, you have to live a hostel life, because my father has lived one. I think at that point of time, I thought that it is not going to be a great decision, but now I feel that it was a really important decision. Those 4 years at hostel life combined with hostel life has really changed me as a person. So I made friends which are now also in contact with me. So I now know how to better manage my time, and also there were so many fun activities. And in the hostel, you also become a little bit independent. So in that particular sense, it is also important.
So if I identify you correctly, Yash, the guy in this white shirt, the specky guy, third from the Sardarji in blue turban, I think that's you. And is that correct?
Yeah, you are correct. The guy who is there in the blue turban, he's our head of the department, Professor Charanjit Singh, and next to him is Professor Surinder, and then Dr. Connell.
Oh, okay. I was talking about the other Sardarji, because you're on the right of him. But yeah, we get it that you are the person in the white shirt. And in the other one, you are this one hugging the guy in hoodie. So it looks like you had a lot of brotherhood during your bachelor's.
Yeah. He's Akashdeep. He's one of my good friends.
I see. So we'll switch gears and now talk about your master's experience.
So I completed my bachelor's in 2014. So after my bachelor's, I went for a master's in thermal engineering in the same year 2014 at Thapar Institute of Engineering and Technology, which is also one of the best colleges in Punjab. It is in Patiala, Punjab. So I had really great time there as well. So there are two pictures that I've just shown there. The first picture is from our seniors' farewell. So all of us are very happy at that point of time. I was also taking part in various other activities at that point of time. So the second picture is from National Service Scheme because I was a member of that, a member at that point of time, and later become department convener also. So we were distributing clothes and books to all the needy children.
That's very nice. I see that being a mechanical engineer and then a thermal engineer, you had like a lot of guys in your class with very few girls. So that would have been, I don't know, disappointing.
We actually had no girl in our bachelor's, and we had only one Kathi
Oh, I feel bad for you.
Tejaswi in our master's.
Cool, Ash. Now that the audience knows you much better, could you tell us what is it that made you decide to pursue a PhD? Was there a particular incident or someone's personality or decision impacted you? What was it that motivated you to pursue a PhD program?
I feel that in everybody's life there are many incidents that impact you one way or the other. I also have many, and I just want to talk about two incidents which I feel that have really impacted me. Both of them are interrelated to each other. One is
I
from my
see.
bachelor's and one is from my master's. So the first incident in regards to my bachelor's is not directly linked to my decision to go for a PhD, but my second incident is somehow related to the decision. Coming to the first incident, you might so we were like 140 students at that point of time, so in mechanical engineering department in my year. So our entire batch was divided basically into two sections. We were having A section and B section with 70 students each. So each section was represented by one class representative. So for section A, there was one class representative. For section B, there was one class representative. So at that point of time, I remember that my friend Arvind was disbursing his responsibilities pretty well. But due to a variety of reasons, he decided that I don't want to carry on with the responsibilities anymore. And back then, people were not ready to take this responsibility because CER basically acts as a bridge between teachers and students. So we had a tough time at that point of time, and we were not having any representative for like 1 month. And then what happened is that in consultation with our professors, we thought that we'll go for a draw system. So everybody has to write his name on a chit, and you just need to put those chits in a box. And one of our professors is going to pick two slips out of that. Why two? Because they have decided that, okay, mechanical engineering department is going to have four class representatives. So they further divided every section into two. So A1, A2, and B1, B2. So fortunately or unfortunately, my and my friend Kamal's name came up. So we were really afraid at that point of time. My God, what has happened, man? How we are going to discuss these responsibilities? We were little afraid at that point of time. The reason being because of our background. We were not from a convent school. We don't know how to speak English, how to speak in front of so many people. And the responsibility also includes talking to director, attend meetings with the head of the department. And the biggest problem was mechanical engineering department was well known for bunks. So there used to be so
And
many
I think
bunks.
you were one of the people who inspired people to bunk classes, and now you had to be the one who had to say, no, you guys can't do that.
You're completely right. So what happened was the professor is going to call the representative only. So tell me why the class, where is the class? Where are you guys? So that was a tough question that every CR has to look into. So then at that point of time, we thought, okay, we are given this opportunity. Let us face to it. Let us face this. So we took that responsibility. At that point of time, it was really hard for me and for Kamal as well, because we were from the same city. But now I feel that decision or the opportunity, the decision to go for this opportunity was really, really happened to be very great. There are a variety of reasons for that. The first thing is that when you represent a class or of like 70 people and to in various meetings in director's room or in HOD's room, and you also organize so many things, you have many different kind of skills that you acquire in the process. So some of the skills are like you acquire communication skills, you have like leadership skills, you also know how to solve problems, and that were really nice. And the other thing is that when I completed this responsibility, when I completed my bachelor's, I think I have a better decisive mind. I was able to take decisions, and it become little easy for me to take decisions. So this was the first incident I just really wanted to show with you. And when my friends are going to look into this interview, they are going to be really happy because I shared this. And the second incident is from my master's. So frankly speaking, when I started my master's, I don't want to go for PhD. PhD was never on my mind at that point of time. Well, I wanted to prepare for
it. I'm so glad that you're sharing things so honestly, because many, many people feel that you know from day one that you wanted to do a master's or a PhD. But for most of us, it's not like that. It's during a particular course or a journey that you realize, okay, probably this is what I want to do. And that is why these journeys become important. So I'm just so happy that you're sharing all of it so transparently.
Yeah. So I really don't want to do PhD. I really don't want to go for PhD. So why I joined my master's was I really wanted to prepare for engineering services exam. So that's what I was doing for my first semester. I was preparing for engineering services. I was not putting any effort into my master's. And because Patiala is a nice place to be, Thapar is a good institute. And if you have any problems with respect to your real subjects, mechanical engineering subjects, you have people who are going to help you. So, but after my first semester, my CGPA dropped like anything. And I was like, man, what is this? You were one of the brightest students in your mechanical engineering department. Now you are not doing anything. So I thought that, no, man, you need to put some effort into this one also. And I started taking my master's a little seriously. So at that point of time, we had different kind of subjects, and we also have very small projects. So in those small projects, we have different tools or instruments that we need to use. And I really enjoyed using those tools. And then my master's is also thesis based. So I really like the idea of solving a problem which is not solved by anyone else. So that's how my interest in research came up. And by the end of my third semester, I made my mind that I'll go for research. At that point of time, I was thinking of doing my research in two particular areas. The first one was water desalination. The second one was energy sciences. So later I decided I'll go for energy sciences.
So it's actually during your master's and then having a bad CGPA in the first semester and then the decisive mind that you created during your bachelor's, all of it sort of coming together and creating this energetic mind that sort of told you that, okay, this I want to pursue PhD and be a researcher in my life.
Yeah, that is the only reason I shared first incident also. So because that is also important.
Yeah, I agree. So now I think we are at a point in your life where you've decided that you want to pursue a PhD and also found out that you want to be an energy scientist. So would you tell us more about the current research that you're doing as part of your PhD program?
Yeah, Namjot. Actually, the broad area in which I'm working is called gas separation. So the project basically has two main objectives. The first objective is, so basically you have a syngas. Syngas is basically a mixture of four gas components. You have carbon monoxide, you have carbon dioxide, methane and hydrogen. So the first objective is to separate carbon dioxide from the syngas to generate a gas which is having module value greater than 2. So module is nothing but H2 minus CO2 over CO plus CO2, this ratio. So this kind of gas is required for methanol synthesis, catalytic methanol synthesis. So the first objective is this one, to separate carbon dioxide, to design a system which can separate carbon dioxide from a mixture of gases. The second objective is to separate carbon dioxide, methane and carbon monoxide from syngas to generate pure hydrogen. This kind of hydrogen is required for PEM fuel cells, proton exchange membrane fuel cells, and as per ISO 14687. So these are the two main objectives of my work. And can you just bring the slides which I have given you so that I can explain them better?
Sure. But before going to that, for a general audience who probably is not that scientific and doesn't understand the scientific lingo better, Can you tell like some common applications of the technologies that you're working on? So say if there's a mixture of gases that highly polluted with carbon dioxide, can your technique be used to remove CO2 from those sort of mixtures or any other applications that a general man could relate with?
In the past, I can bring two examples here. The first thing is that you might be knowing that we import a large quantity of crude oil to generate gasoline and diesel. So the government of India is looking very forward to reduce the import, and they are also looking into methanol, ethanol as alternative fuels, and also electric vehicles are also coming into the picture. Hydrogen is also one of them. The thing is that we have huge quantity of solid waste also available in our country. So if we use that solid waste to generate a gas, which can then be converted into methanol or ethanol, that will be really great, because in that that kind of scenario, you will be solving two main problems. You will be solving the waste, solid waste problem. Secondly, you will be reducing your import. So that's how the government is looking into. The second thing is with respect to hydrogen, electric vehicles have a good future. But electric vehicles, as per various forecastings, electric vehicles cannot be used for heavy transport. For example, if you use electric battery in ships, or you want to use the electric battery in aeroplanes, you might not be able to use it, because as load increases, the size of the battery, the weight of the battery also increases. So we need a fuel which can easily replace gasoline and diesel, which has high density, high energy density, and hydrogen is a fuel which is having high energy density, and it can be easily transported. There are some issues with respect to safety, with respect to storage and transport of hydrogen, but I think those issues are also concurrently being looked into, and they'll also be solved soon. So this is how the government is pitching into.
Yeah, I think this is good for our general audience to understand more and relate more to your research. And now I'm gonna quickly pull up the deck of slides that you asked me to.
So you can see the bottom right picture. So before coming to this picture, I just want to share one thing. So most of the experiments that we generally do in lab are on the fundamental scale. So the project involves studies on a fundamental scale also, and whatever you learn from those from that scale, applying that knowledge to a real world problem or for the technology development. And this is one of the systems that we developed in our lab, which is going to separate carbon dioxide and hydrogen from the syn gas, and generate a modular adjusted syn gas and also pure hydrogen.
But Ash, gas separation processes have been around for a long time now, right? So what is so particular about your research, or so novel about your research, or what is a new problem that you're trying to solve with the separation processes that you are developing?
Yeah, this is a really nice question, Navjot. Actually, the basic principle which we are using here for the separation is called adsorption. So how it is novel, most of the work that has been done in this area is on binary mixtures. Binary mixture means that you have two gases and you are separating it out, or on the ternary gases. So, but none of the researchers have tried using a syn gas mixture which contains four gas components under the operational conditions which we are using currently. So that's how it is a little different from what has been what is available in the literature.
I see. Then in the existing context of COVID and, you know, excessive requirement of oxygen for patients, your technology could also be sort of morphed or modified to address a scenario where instead of separating CO2, you want to separate or obtain high concentrations of oxygen. And I had heard recently that you're also working on a technology on that. So could you tell us more about that?
Navjot, actually, I think many institutes are working in this particular area, and I have seen many social media posts from the official handle of those institutes. IISc was also looking into some of the problems, and IISc also has come up with the different solutions, be it in the diagnostics and surveillance, be it in the hospital assistive devices, or in the vaccine development. So with our lab's experience in gas separation, we came up with a vacuum spring adsorption system, vacuum pressure spring adsorption system, which is going to separate pure oxygen from air. And this is basically a six-step cycle. And currently the trials are going on. The system is manufactured, as you can see in the bottom left. And the second thing is that we are very confident about this thing, and we are very sure about the reliability of the system. Actually, we have designed this system, and we are releasing its design as an open source. So anybody can contact the core team, and we'll release it with the necessary drawings and the logical sequence. But whosoever is using it is required to give a due recognition to the IFT. The overall experience with respect to this project has been very fulfilling. I was really happy to work towards the society, especially in this challenging time.
Great. I am glad that as researchers, we are also able to contribute into the challenging situations that we are facing, not just as a nation, but as humanity today. Just one curious question. What would be the capacity of the system that you're showing in the left-hand picture? And for the audience to understand it in an easier manner, could you tell that, you know, one batch of the processed input air could serve like 10 patients or 10 beds or fill up like N cylinders?
Yeah, this system, the system which you can see, is designed for a hospital which is having like 10 beds. So that kind of hospitals are really common in India rural space. So that's why we came up with the 10 bed design, but we are open to design it for any hospital. If you have 100 beds also, that also we can design.
Great. Okay. Cool, Ash. So I'm going to try switch gears a little here, and we have talked a lot about research and how you decided to do a PhD. So let's come to IISc, the Indian Institute of Science Bangalore, which is ranked as the best university in India for research. Can you tell us more about your academic experience there and sort of also compare it with your experience at your bachelor's college at Thapar, where you did your master's, so that the audience or students who are considering to join IISc could get an idea about what's the level of academics and education at IISc?
Nojoot, actually, when I think about academics, the first thing that come into my mind is coursework. So everybody who is coming into the campus has to complete coursework, which is of 12 credits or 24 credits. So depending upon whether you are coming after your master's or you're coming after your bachelor. So the courses are designed in a beautiful way. They contain a lot of information and that will be really useful in your research. But the coursework demands some sort of dedication. The coursework is rigorous. And with respect to the background from where I was coming from, I have not experienced that kind of rigidity. The second thing is that coming to the research part, the best thing which I liked about IISc is that people are very open towards their research, and they're always open for research discussions. I have my example to share. Some part of my research includes the use of material characterization techniques. And with my background, I was not having any experience in the use of, like, for example, scanning electron microscopy. But I discussed this thing with some of my friends in solid state chemistry unit in TENS and in IPC, and they were really open to help me in that regard. And in that way, IISc is really nice. It's a good place to be. Coming to the comparison part, I think I have many friends in IIT, but a direct comparison might not be possible, because the field is diverse and the research scope and output and other things vary with respect to lab and other things. But based upon the discussion which I had with my friends, I feel that the infrastructure that is available at IISc and also the research opportunities, they are better as compared to many other institutes.
I see. I also feel that the quality of teachers that we have at IISc is very, very different from what we had in our bachelor's. So in bachelor's, we used to be scared, and most of the times we just worried about our grades and not, you know, actually learning about the thing that's being taught to us. And I think the teachers also had a similar style. But when I came to IISc, this is something new that I experienced, that the way the teachers communicate education to you is also different at IISc. Yeah. So
I also have one point to make, that I remember when I was doing my master's, I was only allowed to use 10,000 rupees for my master's thesis. So now at IISc, we don't have any shortage of funding, and there are different fundings that are available. It is just that you should be willing to work, and your professor will somehow he'll be able to get you the funding. So that is the beauty of IISc.
True. And also, this is also something new that I discovered after joining the PhD program, that the PhD program gives you immense opportunities, especially at ISC, to attend a lot of workshops, scientific events, go for international and national conferences, and, you know, connect to scientists all over the world. So how has your experience been like? You've finished almost 3 years now of your PhD? So in these 3 years, what kind of exposure you think being in ISC gave you?
Yeah, Namjot, I also feel that attending conferences and workshops are really important. In addition to conferences and workshops, I feel that attending webinars or exchange studentships and various visiting possibilities that you have are also equally important. There are many advantages of attending different kind of conferences. The first thing is that when you go for a conference, you get to know many, get to meet so many people who are working in your particular area, and you can also discuss your research problems with them, and also you build your connections, which might be useful in the longer run.
True.
The second thing is that I just want to give one example here. I was attending one of the webinars from International Adsorption Society. So in my research, I was facing one problem. So the webinar was based upon that particular thing only. So I asked this problem to the organizer, to the speaker. So I came to know that those guys were also facing the same problem. So there are two things to say here. That first thing is that I was very happy to know that they are also facing the same problem. This means that I'm going in the right direction. The second thing is that he also suggested me some of the solutions that you can use this or you can use this. And I'm going to try all those solutions out once I am back to the campus, because currently I'm sitting at home.
Yeah, this happened with me as well one time. So I was attending this conference and the speaker was talking about the same technique that I use for my research, but for a different application. And at the end, I also asked a question about a problem that I was stuck at and I could not proceed. And then the speaker funnily said that, you know what, we are struggling with the same thing. And both of us had a laugh. And yes, though it sounds weird, but it's reassuring that, you know, okay, it's not that you're stuck at something for months and it's wrong. Other people are also stuck at the same thing. Let you continue now.
Yeah. The other thing is that when you attend any conference or workshop, you also get to know what is the latest trend that is going on into your field. And on the top of that, I also feel that when you apply for a conference or you apply for a summer school or any funding, the process itself is really important. You come across so many things. You need to write your work in like 1,000 words, and that itself is learning. So that's how it is really important to attend any conference. On top of that, one more thing is there, that when you attend any conference in a different country, you come to know about their culture, history, and food as well. So that's how you evolve as a person. That's also really important.
And these conferences also give you an opportunity to make new friends, right? So especially knowing you as a person, you have found these lifelong friends and relationships, I would say, as you have interacted with students who are in ISC on a student exchange program, or when you go out and for different summer schools and conferences. So I think that's also an important part of the journey, as we say.
Yeah, I think that is true. I only attended one conference till now. Basically, it was not a conference for summer school. So I went to Italy. So I also made many good friends there. The friend that you're talking about, who is very close to me, is Chris. So he was one of the exchange students from PU Munich here at ISC.
So Ash, while a PhD is very fulfilling professionally and there's just so many opportunities, different kinds of opportunities that you come across, mental health of PhD scholars and research has also been a very concerning topic all throughout, you know, and these days it's coming even more often, where you hear stories of people being dissatisfied and taking disastrous steps. So what has your experience been like getting into a research program, coming to ISC? And it's not just that you should have a great academic and research support system. You also need an overall environment that sort of keeps you personally satisfied as well. So what kind of challenges have you faced in ISC till now? Did you ever feel sad, disappointed, or depressed? I feel depressed is a very heavy word, and sometimes it's not even used in the right context. So I'm going to leave that to you to use the kind of words and expressions that you want to share your experiences. And more importantly, for people who are listening to us, how did you overcome those challenges?
Navjot, with respect to research, I feel the experience has been great. So I came from a very different background. I have never seen the kind of independence with respect to research and science which we see here at IISc. There are, of course, challenges. There are challenges with respect to adaptability. When you come come to a different place for the first time, it takes some time for you to become comfortable. So adaptability challenges were always there. The other thing is that you miss your friends, you miss your family, you miss the food also. So at that point of time, I was having these challenges. The second thing is that you're going to work in a completely different area, which might or might not be related to your research work. So it takes some time for your research process to become little stable. Coming to your second part of your question, that you ever felt sad, disappointed? Yeah, I feel that becoming sad or disappointed is part of a PhD. It's like an integral part. So there might be a variety of reasons. There might be reasons sometimes your experiments are not working. Sometimes you might not have designed your experiment well. There might be some damage to the facility. Sometimes you feel very alone. So there might be some personal issues as well. And every project at IISc goes with a specific deadline. That also is a problem. And I feel that every research student faces all of these challenges, most of them. The other thing is that how you came out of it. I think the first thing is that everybody needs to know that this problem is being faced by everyone. You are not alone, or it's not rare. It is very common and everybody faces it. The second thing is there might be issues that you are facing, but you need to be more vocal about your issues. You need to tell people, you need to discuss with your friends, you need to discuss with your mentor that this is what I am facing and what might be the possible solution with respect to that. The third thing is that we have a variety of clubs. We have a sports club, we have dance club, we have gymkhana. So people should participate. People can go for a run, they can go and play badminton in the TMC or in the gymkhana. There are a variety of things available. I also felt that in the institute, there is one thing very common, which is unhealthy comparison. So people compare your work with somebody else, somebody else. So I feel that people should refrain from those things, because everybody has a different life, different problem. And this might be true that if you are doing something today, you might not also be able to publish it in a better journal or something like that. There are also issues that can be solved if you are a little proactive, you are disciplined with respect to your work, and you have some sort of determination. I feel that that will also help in somehow.
So this point that you talked about, where you said that most projects at IISc have a deadline, I feel that in a way it's good, because you sort of know that, you know, this is the time frame in which you're expected to solve a problem. Otherwise, many a times we become complacent and sort of take our time for granted, and maybe we might not be that focused or planned in doing our work, but these deadlines sort of help us. But at the same time, they can be very stressful. So that's when you become more communicative. You talk to your lab mates, you talk to your professors, you talk to your friends, and you get to know that, oh, everyone is going through this. And most of the times in my experience, I found that seniors would give you these valuable inputs that help you tweak what you're doing and find out your ways and solve a problem that's at your hand. So even I feel personally that being communicative has been the most important thing. Whether it's your family, your parents, your friends, your professor, your PhD mentor, all this really helps bring down the amount of mental stress that might be mounting up on your head.
Yeah, very true.
So you also shared some pictures with your friends that you wanted to talk about. So I'm going to bring them up now, and we'll look at the lighter moments of a PhD life.
So in these pictures, I've tried to cover most of the people who are very close to me at the institute. So you can see the first picture at the top left corner. They are my friends Kaveshi, Shruti and Anam. We went for a walk to the Jubilee Garden. That's where we clicked this picture. The second picture is with my technicians Anantha, CK and Shankar, and they play a really important role in the PhD. The third is our research group picture. this we clicked during the eve of Dussehra. You can see me in turban. So the
oh,
picture,
so the blue one, the blue yeah, fellow, yeah, yeah. The blue turban fellow. Yeah. Oh, okay.
So the fourth picture, which is at the bottom left corner, is from the Open Day. Open Day is one of the big events in the campus. So you can see that many people visit our lab at that day. This fifth picture is from last year when we were celebrating my birthday. So these are the lighter moments that we generally enjoy at IIT.
I see. And I'm going to be offended because you don't have me in any of these pictures and you said that all your close friends are there. So
you're there in the, you're
so
there in the next
I'm
slide.
I'm going to see how you're going to make up for our one. Now we know pretty much all about your PhD experience till now, Ash, and let's talk about future now. So what are your expectations, or what were your expectations when you joined the PhD program? How much of those you feel have been fulfilled over these years, and how does your future look like? What opportunities are you looking at in your future, and where would you like to take your research from here?
Yeah, as I mentioned, Avjot, research has always made me excited. I was for my master's, I was really interested to pursue research as a career, and I felt that there is not going to be a better place than IIT to pursue research. I always wanted to work on a problem which is related to the real world and that can be utilized in the society, and I feel that I am working on a similar problem. With respect to expectations, I still feel that my expectations and the path is still evolving. And talking about the future, I know that there is very tough competition in academics because there are so many PhDs that are coming up every year. There are limited opportunities in the industry as well. Therefore, I am looking into entrepreneurship also as a career path, and I'm looking forward to it.
Great. It'll be nice if in a few years I see something like Ash Corporation. Another thing that most researchers have in common is that apart from their basic research or the theme that they're interested in, there are one or more causes that they are passionate about, whether it be education or pollution, climate change. There are n number of themes, and every researcher sort of has a soft corner for one or the other theme, which is not directly related to their research. So what are the passions that you carry in your heart and causes that you care for?
I think, Navjot, inspiring students from the rural background or people from far-flung areas towards science is really important. That is most important now during the current pandemic, because science is showing us that what kind of importance it has. The second thing is that towards this, I was working for this cause. I was a member of a group called Science for Rural India, and we used to visit various government, Karnataka government schools at weekends. So this is done in consultation with the Karnataka State Council for Science and Technology. We used to show them basic science experiments, which are directly linked to their day-to-day life. And that's how a link is also made. We also used to aware them about the career opportunities that are available in science. So that's how we were contributing, and we are going to contribute once this pandemic is over. And nowadays, we had some online meetings, and we are looking into, looking to make online content where we'll be sharing all the experiments. We'll make videos of those experiments, and we'll try to show those experiments virtually to the students. That's how we are going ahead.
I think with the schools closed down and students not getting access to even basic education, and in many, many parts of our country, these kind of initiatives would be really helpful to at least help them get the basic education that every student or every child, I would say, deserves.
Yeah, that's very important. I also would like to mention that the group was also carrying very different activities in the institute also. So during Open Day, we used to organize an event called Kids Zone, where we see thousands of students that are coming in every year to see those basic science experiments. And every time we saw an increase in the number of people that are coming in. So that's how we were contributing.
Okay, I'm just going to show a short glimpse of pictures of the causes that you care about and the participation that you've done in them.
Yeah.
Okay, so finally you have one picture in your deck of slides where I can see myself, And this bottom right picture, I think we took it last year when new joinees were joining IIC and it was two hot summers. And we decided that continuing our Punjabi culture of serving chabil to people who are thirsty and in need, we set up this table with a bunch of friends and parents and students who were coming in, getting their hostel allocations and admission processes done. We were serving them. And I think the Ash, the top picture is from one of the schools that you visited
for your
science experiments.
This is one of the schools that we visited during science outreach activities.
And
the bottom two pictures are from my trip to Italy. In the bottom left picture, you can see all of us with the ambassador to Italy, Indian ambassador to Italy, Mrs. Reenath Sandhu. And the top picture is from Gandhi Jayanti, where we were representing Punjab. In this picture also, you are also there. So you can see yourself standing with a green dupatta, I guess.
Anyways, I'm too small to show people and for them to identify me in this picture.
Yeah.
And when you say trip to Italy, this is your summer school that you went to for
in Italy, right?
Great. So you bring us closer to your lighter moons of PhD life at IIC.
Yeah, thank you, Nojo.
So to conclude our conversation, Ash, and to put everything into perspective, and I started this channel with the major motivation to increase sound science outreach activities and motivate young, enthusiastic kids who probably either have had exposure to science or did not have exposure to science to know more about how students get into the field, what kind of careers are to be followed, what kind of dreams do people have and how they accomplish it. So, looking at where you come from, so this is, you know, completing the circle and going back to your first slide of that small town of Kotkapura in this big state of Punjab, in this big country of India. How do you see that people in your hometown or students who are now doing bachelor's from your college or doing master's from Thapar, what kind of exposure do they have today? And is that enough for them to sort of know if they want to pursue careers in science? And can you even make some suggestions as to what can be changed to encourage people to pursue science as their career?
Starting from my hometown, I feel that people have very limited exposure. People don't know about IIC at all. People know about IIT, but IIT also, they know about IIT Roorkee or IIT Delhi, but they don't know about IIT Kharagpur, IIT Bombay or other IITs. So is the case with the exams as well. People know about IIT, there is an exam called IIT JEE. But people do not know about KVPY, through which you can enter into IIC as an undergrad student. I have one personal story to share here. So after completing my master's, I thought that I'll go for a PhD. So my father told some of our relatives that he is going for PhD to IIC Bangalore. So because people were not aware of this thing, and one of our relatives said that, he is not able to get any university in Punjab. That's why he is going to Bangalore. So my father asked me, man, why are you not applying to, you're not applying to Thapar or you're not applying to IIT Roorkee? And that's how, like, people are not aware of IIC as well. So thing is, coming to the second part of your question, that how we can improve that. I was reading through the newspapers. There is a news from last week. So I was reading about that IIT Gandhinagar has signed one MOU with the Gujarat government. So what they are going to do is that all the government engineering colleges that are under Gujarat government, they are going to take top 10 students from every branch who are there in their final year. So they are going to spend that last semester at IIT Gandhinagar. So you, for example, if you have n number of colleges, you have 5 branches per college. So and every 10 students
are
going to.
That's a great initiative.
Yeah. So you are going to spend one semester at a top institute, and you are going to get first experience about research and all those things. And I feel that that kind of initiative can be repeated in all other states, because you see that we have IITs in every state, we have NITs, we have other tier 1 engineering colleges as well. For example, we have Thapar and PEC in Punjab, in addition to NIT Jalandhar and IIT Roorkee. So I feel that the people who are there in government engineering colleges, they can spend some time at these institutes, and that would be really nice for them. The other thing is that the kind of initiative which Karnataka State Council for Science and Technology is doing, like science outreach activities, that kind of activities we can also start doing in most of the IITs or in NITs as well. So that's how you can increase your outreach. I know that similar to IISc, IIT Delhi is also doing open day every year. So other institutes can also follow the same. Coming to the school education, there are one thing I just want to point out, that the role of teachers is really important. And if you have people, for example, when we visit these schools through this science outreach activity, people know about Dr. Kalam, people know about Professor C.N. Rao, people know about Sir C.V. Raman, but they do not know about their life or the struggles of the work that they have done. So there needs to be a slight variation, a slight change in the syllabus of these school children also. That will also really help. So I feel that these might be the points which can be taken care of.
I feel you've really thought about these issues and especially about education of young children. And I hope that as you grow older, the fire for these passions grows and you're able to sort of bring a change in these areas in the society. Yeah. It was great having a chat with you, Arsh. And thank you so much for being candid and honest and sharing whatever you had experienced throughout these years of your bachelor's, master's and PhD and other life experiences as well. I wish you all the luck for your PhD. I hope you are able to finish the goals that you have started out with and give us technologies, give the society technologies that can change their lives. Thank you so much for being on the Science Chat show and talking to us.
Yeah, thank you so much, Navjot. I also wish the same for you and my best wishes for your YouTube channel.